A Bloomberg U.S. dollar index rose the most in February since September. Joining us to talk currencies is Jeff Nang, Senior Currency Analyst for Global Markets Research of MUFG. Hi, Jeff. Welcome to Market Edge.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning. So let's start with the big picture. There's all this talk about, you know, dollar peak, the worst of King Dollar's rampage from last year already behind us, and a structurally weaker greenback lies ahead. Are you now a dollar bear?
Well, it looks like a story for two halves at this stage. Unfortunately, we have seen quite a lot of dollar rebound over the past month or so in February. I think owing to the fact that there's expectations of the U.S. hiking by 50 basis points more since the start of February. And I think that has also caused the U.S. dollar to gain momentum, especially as inflation remains sticky. So I think the overall implication is that the U.S. is likely to hold the interest rates higher for longer. And I think that could continue to propel at some dollar strength, especially as we head to the middle of the year. But I think eventually by the end of the year, what we are looking for is the Fed turning more neutral to dovish, and that may trigger some dollar weakness by the end of the year.
Mm-hmm. All right. So how strong are you seeing the dollar by mid-year? And when you say higher for longer, how high? 6%?
Well, I think for now, markets have priced in a terminal Fed fund target rate of around 5.25 to 5.5%. So that means three more rate hikes from now after the 25 basis point rate hike on the 1st of February. And of course, if looking at current data, a 6% rate hike is not totally out of the equation, especially if the inflation stays stickier than expected. What we are seeing right now is that the U.S. consumer has quite a number of years of savings, and they are turning their spending towards services. So the services inflation is relatively high, mm-hmm. and I think that's continuing to underpin the high inflationary pressures in the U.S.
Mm-hmm. You touched on my next question briefly. When you look at the Fed and the economy, I mean, you've got inflation much stickier than initially expected, rates, as you said, to stay higher for longer, and now people, you know, seem to have moved from a narrative of hard landing to the possibility of a soft landing to maybe no landing at all. What narrative do you subscribe to?
Well, in fact, I would subscribe to the two ends of the spectrum. I think for now, the economic data is looking at no landing because recently the U.S. consumer continued to spend, and services growth continued to be relatively strong for the time being. But I think as the U.S. Raises interest rates to very high levels and keep them there, I think the issue is that something may break. So perhaps by the end of this year or next year, we are likely to see some slowdown more markedly in the U.S. And I think that may cause a landing that could be harder going forward.
All right. What about Asian currencies? I mean, the dollar's weakness has been a big boost to many central banks here, but how does it all play out against, of course, the backdrop of whether the country has a current accounts deficit like the Philippines or a surplus?
Yes, absolutely. I think last year was the year of yield differentials because the U.S. hiked by more than 400 basis points. This year, while the U.S. continues to hike and keep rates higher for longer, we don't anticipate such rate increases of this magnitude. So I think going forward, it will likely be on the current account balances from each of the various economies. They will likely cause the currency performances to be different. For the Philippines, for instance, you know, we are anticipating some positivity because we are likely to see some normalization. After a very bad year of a current account deficit, we're expecting some normalization. So having a reduced current account deficit is a positive for the Philippines and the peso.
Mm-hmm. All right. The euro. I also am very curious about where you see the euro, because I remember 7 months ago, we hit a milestone, the euro hitting parity with the U.S. dollar for the first time in 20 years. What's your view on the euro? Is it time to buy?
I think there's still some volatility ahead, and I will look for good levels to purchase again. I think in the near term, the euro has been resilient because of the fact that the ECB continues to hike quite aggressively. But near-term expectations of further US rate hikes may dampen the euro dollar further. But what we're anticipating is, by the end of the year, if the ECB continues to be more neutral and leaning towards the hawkish front, whereas the Fed turns more dovish, I think that could, you know, in fact, bring the euro dollar to 1.12. So yeah, we continue to have a long euro dollar view in the long term.
Okay, and bringing the conversation back closer to home in Asia, Japan. Let's talk about the yen. What will the forex market look like with a new Bank of Japan Governor Kazuo Ueda? I mean, we heard from him last week. He actually cooled speculation of an earlier end to the ultra-easy monetary policy, but left the door open for tweaking the yield curve control in the future. What's the expectation there?
Yes, I think expectations are sky high over the past few months, and I think recently they have tapered off. So I think that has caused some yen weakness. I think when the year progresses, what we are likely to see is that the inflation is still likely to be high by historical standards in Japan, and that may cause the Bank of Japan to slightly tweak its yield curve control policy, mm-hmm. and perhaps scrap the yield curve control policy, but look towards removing slightly some of the ultra accommodative monetary policy. So that will help to bring forward some yen rebound in the coming year, even as you know, in the near term, the euro may continue weakening on the decrease and diminished expectations after, you know, the unexpected sort of like increase in the yield curve target by the Bank of Japan in December. That's caused expectations to skyrocket, and now just that expectations are now more diminished compared to that of January.
All right. On that note, Jeff, thank you so much for joining us and for the insights. Good to see you.
Thank you.
Just a big update, quick update rather. The Philippine peso is steady, opening at 55.30 against the US dollar from yesterday's close of 55.33. An update on the stock markets now. The PSEI finally seeing some relief, a bounce back this morning. First 5 minutes of trade, the index is up 0.6%, 36 points. We're at 65.92. For those who are watching, you know, yesterday's drop to 65.56, we essentially wiped out all of this year's gains and then some, because if you remember, we ended last year at 65.66, so we went even lower than that. It's like January and February's rally did not happen at all. So where do we move forward? Let's see. But so far this morning, it seems like some investors are taking this opportunity to buy at attractive valuations. That's what some analysts are telling us. Going over some interesting corporate stories now. The BSP saying that February inflation print is likely to beat January's 14-year high of 8.7%. The expectation is that inflation for February will come in within a range of 8.5 to 9.3%. IBPAP saying this is the organization for IT BPM companies. They saw revenues jump 10% last year to $32.5 billion. Workforce also growing 8% to 1.57 million workers in that sector. Alter Energy, which is in the IPO pipeline for this year, they bagged three more wind energy service contracts, which brings their total contracts to four. That's from the government there. PSE also launching their Learn IPO Strategies and Tactics, or so-called LIST Masterclass, this Thursday. Of course, next week is the Investment Expo, the second one. So exciting, again, for those who are interested in the capital markets. AgriNurture of Tony Chu says they're pushing through with their 280 million peso stock rights offer. And for those who missed this yesterday, Manila Water posted 5.9 billion pesos in net income. SM Investments also growing their net income by 53% in 2022 in a very strong post-pandemic recovery. We're actually showing you the breakdown there. All of the units posting very strong double-digit growth there for full year of 2022. China Bank still connected to the C family, also reporting a 27% jump in net income for full year 2022 to 19.1 billion. Semirara Mining beating their record, crushing their record from 2021. Net income jumping 146%. That's more than doubled what they posted in 2021. Net income at 39.9 billion. So all of these were earnings numbers that came out yesterday, closer to the end of trading. But we have this just in, Mega World I think we have the numbers. Megaworld there, net income 15.4, up 7% for the full year of 2022. Revenue up by 17% to nearly 60 billion. Actually, all of their core businesses saw double-digit growth. Just an update from Vivant Corporation, their subsidiaries buying a solar power plant with a facility with a target capacity of 22 megawatts in Bulacan. And Pilipinas Shell has secured a 9 billion peso medium-term loan that's split evenly between BPI and Metrobank. This is supposed to cover for their needs in the short term and try to cut exposure to high rates.